Good morning, everyone. How are we today? It's a beautiful day, and it's a beautiful day to worship the Lord. Let's stand up together as we sing this morning.
Power of our God, Almighty Fortress, you go before us.
Aren't you faithful, or aren't you thankful today that no matter what we face, our God is faithful? Amen. That we can come and sing with joy even when things are difficult. Even when we face trial of many forms, we know that our God loves us, that he's faithful to draw near and to walk with us through this journey of life. Well, over the past week, we had the eclipse come through and just so many conversations of, you know, what it means off that path of totality and where it crosses in America and all these questions of what city was underneath the eclipse in full. And, you know, as we have a world that is, you know, seeking the sensational, seeking questions to many answers, today I encourage you to remember that we have a God who's faithful, that we have a God who is our answer. So I'm going to read a few passages for you today. Maybe one of them will hold in your heart and minister to you where you're at. Maybe give you the courage and the reminder of the next step before you. So hear the word of God today. Isaiah 43:16-19 says, "This is what the Lord says, who makes a way in the sea and a path through the raging water, who brings out the chariot and the horse and the army and the mighty one together. They lie down, they do not rise again. They are extinguished, put out like a wick. Do not remember the past events. Pay no attention to the things of old. Look, I am doing something new. Even now it is coming. Do you not see it? Indeed, I will make a way in the wilderness and rivers in the desert." Lamentations 3:22-24. "Because of the Lord's faithful love, we do not perish, for his mercies never end. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. I say, the Lord is my portion. Therefore, I will put my hope in him." I'm going to read that last statement again. "The Lord is my portion, therefore I will put my hope in him." Still early, my bad. I'm going to move us to the New Testament. This is 2 Corinthians 1:20. "For every one of God's promises is yes in him," meaning Jesus. "Therefore, through him, we all say amen to the glory of God." In 2 Timothy 2, this saying, and this is verse 11-13, "This saying is trustworthy, for if we died with him, we will also live with him. If we endure, we will also reign with him. If we deny him, he will also deny us. And listen to this, if we are faithful, he remains faithful, for he cannot deny himself." That's the heart of our God today.
Faithful, you are. Faithful. pure, you have brought me near. You pulled me from the ashes, you have broken every curse. Blessed Redeemer, you have set this captive free. Lord, I can't help but
today for his faithfulness. Oh God, we thank you that you are constant when the world is not, that you're faithful when everything seems to fade away. And today, God, we stand proclaiming who you are, that you keep your promises, that you're a good and faithful God. Just take a minute just to thank God, to welcome him into the place we're at today.
You are here, you're moving in our midst. Worship you. here, you're working in this place. I worship you, I worship you. You are here, moving in honest. I worship you, I worship you. You are here, working in this place. I worship you, I worship you.
He's the way maker.
You are way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are.
Sing that again.
You are miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are.
You are here.
You are here, touching every heart. I worship you, I worship you. You are here, stop working, you never stop, you never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop working. You never stop working. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise. God, that is who you are. You are way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are.
Just our voice today, you are.
You are way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are.
One more time, you are the way maker.
You are way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are.
But today, God, your church aligns in remembrance of your faithfulness. You're so worthy of our praise, of our devotion today, God. And as the songs we just sang said, today, God, I thank you that while we come to pour out praise, to glorify your name, as you've designed us to do, as you rightly deserve, you're faithful to mend hearts, to move in our midst. Oh, God, we trust you. Help us trust you more. It's in your name that we pray. Amen. Go ahead and grab a seat.
Well, good morning, church. I think the beauty of worship is that it's this opportunity for us to pause and to take our focus off of us, right? Not to look at just me and my circumstances, but to step back and look at God for who he is. And when we do that, we can't help but worship. And I find that when I do that, when I acknowledge God for who he really is, I have a different view of myself. I have a different view of my circumstances. And so I don't know about you, but I needed that this morning of just being able to come, set those things aside and worship God for who he is. So I'm grateful that we get to do this together, that we get to corporately together gather and worship God as a body. And so I'm encouraged as I hear voices around me worshiping, as I get to interact with those who are here. So we're grateful that you chose to be here this morning to worship and to participate in what God has in store for you. If you're here for the very first time, we're so grateful that you are. My name is Josh Harrod, if we haven't met, and I'm privileged to be one of the pastors here at Pleasant Valley. And we would love to meet you and just know that you're here, especially for the very first time. The best way to do that, for you to let us know that you're joining us this morning for the first time, is the communication card at the bottom of the info sheet that you received coming in. Would just encourage you to fill that out. You can place that in the offering basket as it's passed here shortly. And we would love to meet you. And so we have a table at the back called Guest Connect, where one of our staff or ministry partners would love to meet you, just be able to encourage you to offer any next steps and also offer a gift to you. And so I want to do this. We don't do this regularly, but I want to invite you to go ahead and complete that communication card right now. And if you say, well, I'm not a first-time guest, if you're a regular PVer, you can use the backside of that to share any prayer requests or any next steps that you need to take. And so we're gonna do this. We're gonna take about 20 seconds, and we're just gonna pause where you can complete that communication card. And if that doesn't apply to you, I would just encourage you to look over this info card that has a number of upcoming opportunities and things that you need to be aware of. So go ahead and take about 20 seconds to go ahead and fill out that card or take a look at the info sheet. If you've been around Pleasant Valley for any length of time, you probably know that one of our values as a church is to be for the family. And there's a number of ways that we do that, but one of them is to invest in marriages. And so yesterday, I had the privilege of being a part of a first-time event here at Pleasant Valley. We hosted a marriage conference for those who are early in marriage, so 5 years or less. And I was just blown away by the response to that. We had 20 couples who spent a Friday night and all day Saturday investing in their marriages. And this was in partnership with our counseling center. And so it was all counselors from the counseling center who provided the content for that. And just some incredible tools and opportunity for these couples to engage and just invest in their marriage. And I was just reminded as we did that, that is because of ultimately your generosity. It's your generosity that makes opportunities like that possible as you give to the ministries here at Pleasant Valley, because we are committed to family and to marriages. And so I just want to say thank you as being a recipient of that, as a participant in that. I know that was an incredible win. And so I just want to say thank you on behalf of those couples and all those in the future who are going to be impacted by that. So at this time, our ushers are going to receive the offering. Well, as I mentioned earlier, worshiping together is not just an individual experience. That's a corporate experience. And so we want you to have an opportunity to meet the people who are sitting right around you and greet them. And I'll just encourage you, you're going to have about a minute to do that. And at the end, we want you to just go ahead and remain standing as my friend Leo is going to come and share our scripture for today. So go ahead and stand, greet the people around you, and introduce yourself to someone.
Good morning, church. It's a blessing for me to be here today with you to read the Word of God, the Psalm 23 in Spanish. Salmo de David. El Señor es mi pastor, nada me falta. En verdes pastos me hace descansar. Junto a tranquilas aguas me conduce. Me infunde nuevas fuerzas. Me guía por sendas de justicia, por amor a su nombre. Aun si voy por valles tenebrosos, no temo peligro alguno, porque tú estás a mi lado. Tu vara de pastor me reconforta. Dispones ante mí un banquete en presencia de mis enemigos. Has ungido con perfume mi cabeza. Has llenado mi copa a rebosar. La bondad y el amor me seguirán todos los días de mi vida, y en la casa del Señor habitaré para siempre. May the Lord bless the reading of his word. Amen.
Thank you, Leo. To all of my friends who Spanish is their heart language, I've been told that Spanish is the language of heaven. So, buenos días, or maybe buenos tardes, right? I don't know which one. Good morning. There we go.
Hey, I'm really glad that you're here. My name is Merle. What a joy it is to be with everybody here in the worship center, everybody that is in the chapel, all of you who are in the commons, and everybody that is online. Pleasant Valley, would you join me in greeting one another and greeting our first-time guest? So I've been told, and nobody has tried to dissuade me of this, that we live in anxious times. And this week I was talking to one of the folks that lives in my neighborhood, and they're getting ready to sell their home and move out because the cost of living has just become so incredibly exorbitant for them. And we talked about food prices and all of that. And then if you couple that with all the things that have happened in Ukraine and then the latest news last night about Iran shooting missiles and drones over at Israel, from our news feeds as well as just the people that we talk to, it's like we're flooded with all of these anxiety-producing experiences or news. And so we're in a series about how do you cultivate living a non-anxious life? If there's all kinds of events outside of our control that can gin up anxiety in our life, how do we go about dealing with it in a way where anxiety is not insurmountable, but God is? And God offers us a new and a different way to live this way. One of the books that I've picked up here recently is a book by Alan Fadling called A Non-Anxious Life. And one of the things that Fadling does in the very introduction of the book is he spent some time talking about the different faces that anxiety has had in his own life. And I'm going to share with you a couple of his faces of anxiety, and I'm going to share with you a couple of my faces of anxiety, and see if any of these represent maybe what you have experienced in your life. He says anxiety sometimes puts on the face of an operating system. All of us who have computers know that in the inner workings of the computer that we cannot see, there is a operating system that manages all of the apps and controls all of the different software, and anxiety can be like that. It can be like an internal thing that we do not see, but it runs all of the stuff that is underneath the surface. It's an ever-present internal operating system running our thoughts and running our feelings. And he says another face of anxiety in his own life is the anxiety puts on the face of a bad counselor. Now, around Christmas time, we always focus on Jesus as being the wonderful counselor. He says, well, anxiety is not wonderful. Anxiety is a bad counselor. And it wants to be our counselor every single day. It urges us to let it give us advice for the present and for the future. And if you think about it, if you and I have listened to anxiety long enough, whether or not we've ever identified it this way, but anxiety for some of us has been our primary mentor all of our lives. But its guidance assumes not abundance, it assumes scarcity. It assumes fear as opposed to confidence. Anxiety counsels us to speed it up while the Spirit of God is telling us to slow it down. Now, those were two of his six faces of anxiety. I have a couple for me. One is the guy with the hair on fire. I've never seen somebody, with the exception of Michael Jackson, with his hair on fire, and that was old school. I mean, that was the only time I've ever seen that. And so, but I have had the internal experience, and so has Karen, of me being the guy with his hair on fire, especially if there is a medical situation in the family that includes either pain or blood. That happens, and it's like, I don't know what to do. It's like I'm running in place going, help me, I don't know what to do. And it's insane. Karen, on the other hand, in the midst of those kind of things, she's calm, she's stable, she's unflappable, and I'm thanking God for that. Otherwise, you know, children would have bled out completely, or, you know, people would have just been agonizing in pain, and I'd have just been running around going, what do I do? What do I do? It's the reason that I don't serve on the hospital team, because they don't want me to go to the hospital because I just make people feel worse whenever I got there. And so Anxiety is also worn the face of a false prophet. Now, in the Old Testament, false prophets claim to speak for God, but you know they're a false prophet if what they proclaim and prophesy is going to happen doesn't happen, and that's what anxiety does. Anxiety often prophesies what's going to happen in the future in an uncertain, unseen circumstance, and most of the time it doesn't come true. And so maybe what I ought to do is I ought to stone the false prophet inside of myself when it puts on that face. Now, we can cultivate a non-anxious life, and we don't have to wear those kind of faces because God offers us something better in Psalm 23. And for those of you who are with us for the very first time, Leo read beautifully Psalm 23 in Spanish, and we're going to loiter in Psalm 23 until I sense that we're done with it, and so we're going to be with it for a little bit. And what I'm going to do is we're going to read it out loud together. You don't have to stand up. We're going to read it out loud together because part of what you and I are doing in terms of spiritual disciplines is that one of the spiritual disciplines that helps us to live lives more like the person of Jesus Christ is, like Jesus, we quote scripture in the midst of challenges and troubles like Jesus did when he was tempted. And like Jesus, we learn to memorize scripture so that we don't necessarily have to have our book or our phone to be able to find the passage. And so we're going to keep reading Psalm 23, and toward the end, I'm just going to let us read without the crutch of the screen. So here we go. We're going to read it out loud together. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Dallas Willard made this great statement. It's a convicting statement. But he said this: "The Lord is my shepherd" is written on many more tombstones than lives. If you're ever to go to a cemetery, you might often see portions of Psalm 23 on the headstone, and he says from his experience, it's more evident in a cemetery than it is written on the lives of individuals like you and I. So my desire, my prayer, my hope, my commitment, my work, week in and week out while we're in this series, Cultivating a Non-Anxious Life, is simply this: I want Psalm 23 to be written on your life. I want it to be all over our lives. And to help us do that today, we're going to focus on three things: who God is, who you are, and third of all, what God provides. So let's jump right in. Let's talk about who God is. We spent some time talking about that last week by simply focusing on the word Lord. Now we're going to spend some time focusing on this whole idea of shepherd. It says in verse 1, "The Lord is my shepherd." And has anybody in the chapel, anybody in the foyer, anybody in this room right here, if you'll raise your hand really high, how many of you have ever served as a professional shepherd? I'm not talking about your children. I'm talking about those woolly, well, that could be your children. I'm talking about, okay, there isn't anybody here, and you've probably seen pictures of shepherds and sheep, and probably oftentimes when you think about a shepherd and sheep, you have this pastoral feeling, and it feels warm and cozy and comforting. I know that when I grew up in my family, we had a picture that was in one of the rooms of the house that had Jesus carrying this lamb, and it was so docile and it was so peaceful and everything, but probably so far removed from what a shepherd actually did. So when David uses the word shepherd to speak about God, for him, it's one of the most comprehensive yet intimate kind of images that he could use. Oftentimes the Psalms speak of God as a rock or a shield, but David in Psalm 23 talks about God being a shepherd. He's not distant, because shepherds don't live distantly from their sheep back in the day. They actually lived with the flock and was everything to the flock. So I'm going to point out just some qualities of a shepherd that relate to who God is. And as we go through Psalm 23, we'll delve into these a little bit more in depth. But this is what you're going to see that a shepherd is like. Like a shepherd, first of all, God is a God who protects. That's what a shepherd did. A shepherd would defend the sheep from all kinds of wild beasts. They would defend the sheep from bad weather as well. They sought to protect the sheep. Isaiah 40 verse 11 uses this phrase to speak about God. He protects his flock like a shepherd. God protects you like a shepherd. He gathers the lambs in his arms and he carries them in the fold of his garment. And he gently leads those that are nursing. So there's this idea that God is your protector. And one of the things that you need to know in the midst of struggling with any kind of anxiety, when anxiety wants to come as a false prophet and say, nobody knows, nobody cares, nobody's going to take care of you, you are out on your own, life is going to be too hard, you're going to be decimated by what you do not know, you need to remind yourself who God is. And when you say that the Lord is your shepherd, the Lord is your protector, but not only that, he's your provider. The shepherd manages the food supply for the sheep, knows where the green pastures are, knows when to get them out of the barren pastures, knows where there is still water to drink so that they are taken care of. And one of the things that we're going to see in here in a little bit is this whole idea of too many of us listen to anxiety, and anxiety says you're never going to have enough. You're always going to do without. It's always going to be limited, and there's always going to be scarcity. And the Bible says, no, that's not who God is. God is also your doctor. He doctors you. He doctors you, or he heals you. The shepherd tends to the wounds and the diseases of the sheep and has to constantly be alert of what would be bothering the sheep. Back whenever I was growing up, I lived in sheep and goat and cattle country. And one of the things that those folks who had sheep do, they would dip the sheep. And part of dipping the sheep in a certain kind I don't want to call it antibiotic, and I don't want to call it a herbicide or a pesticide. There we go. It's good to know that your pastor is so well read. And so they would put this pesticide on the sheep because the sheep don't really have a tail like a horse to kind of keep the flies away, and so they would doctor the sheep. Jesus wants to bring healing to your soul. He doctors you along the way. A shepherd also disciplines. One of the things that a shepherd will do is a shepherd will monitor how the flock is getting along with each other. The shepherd will monitor whether or not he's got any wild sheep that need to be tended to. And we'll talk a little bit in the series about the shepherd's rod and the staff. They're all part of disciplining. God will sometimes discipline us in life whenever we are walking away into places that are going to cause greater and greater damage to our lives. He disciplines us because he loves us. A shepherd rescues. Whenever a sheep would wander off into a dangerous place, get caught in a thicket, what would a shepherd do? A shepherd would search relentlessly for the sheep, and he would risk his own life for the sheep. Jesus one day was talking to the religious leaders who were having a problem with the people that he hung out with. They didn't think that he should be hanging out with people they didn't like, that they didn't think were appropriate, that they were outside of the acceptable. Jesus tells them a parable using a shepherd and a sheep. He says, what man among you who has 100 sheep and loses one of them does not leave the 99 in the open field and go after the lost one until he finds it? Now, most of us probably wouldn't do that. We'd go, hey, I got 99, that's good. But a good shepherd says, no, I'm going to go after the one that's lost. When he's found it, he joyfully puts it on his shoulders. Coming home, he calls his friends and neighbors together, saying to them, "Rejoice with me because I have found my lost sheep." I tell you, in the same way, there's more joy in heaven over one sinner who repents than over 99 righteous people who don't need repentance. Jesus Christ has come to rescue you. I am a rescued sheep. He took me out of the thickets of my own stupidity. He pulled me from the deep crevices of decisions I made that were destroying my life. He rescued me when I didn't think that there was any rescue whatsoever. That's the kind of shepherd he is. And not only that, as a good shepherd, he companions us. He companions us. A shepherd was everything to the sheep. And as I said, the shepherd walked among the sheep, and the shepherd would actually know his sheep by name. For instance, several shepherds could bring into a pen several different flocks of sheep, and each flock of sheep was tuned in to the distinct sound of their shepherd's voice, and another shepherd could call to them, and they would not come, but if their shepherd called, they would come. Jesus said of himself in John 10:27, "My sheep hear my voice, I know them, they follow me." That's the kind of shepherd God is for us. Here's what I know about all of us. We all have a shepherd, everyone. Everybody's got a shepherd. We all listen to some voice. We've all paid attention to some kind of voice that guides and leads our life. If your shepherd is your job or your financial portfolio or what other people think of you or your image or alcohol or greed or relationship or success, my question is, when you go through the deep, dark valleys of life, which we all will, is that shepherd gonna be able to protect you, provide for you, heal you, discipline you, rescue you, or be your companion? And the answer is no. It's not. And it's not that some of those things are bad, but none of them are a shepherd worth giving yourself totally and completely to. God is the one true shepherd who has shown himself to us in the person of Jesus Christ. That's who God is. Who are you? Who are you? That's what we're going to talk about next. David was a shepherd himself. So he knew the role well, but in this particular psalm, he flips the script. He doesn't say, "I'm a shepherd." David says, "The Lord is my shepherd." And so what is he doing? He is in essence saying this, "I'm a sheep. If God is a shepherd, then I am a sheep." Did you know that the Bible talks about sheep more than it does any other animal in the Bible? Mentions cattle 131 times, dogs 41 times, eagles 26 times. Do you know the animal that's not mentioned in the Bible? I'm not going to say, but I will say this unmentioned animal in the Orthodox Church is the only animal that is allowed to enter into the temple.
Meow.
Please don't write me an email. I actually love cats. We had a cat for 17 years. I say this every time I mention cats. I know you love cats. I love cats. I just like making fun. Is that okay? I don't know why I keep doing this, honey. I do this all the time, and then I just cannot help myself. I'm listening to the voice of a shepherd right now, and it's a bad shepherd. Taking me to bad places. Sheep and shepherds are mentioned in the Bible about 500 times because maybe more than any kind of human-animal connection, it tells us something deeply about our own human condition. We are like sheep. Sheep need help. Sheep need a shepherd. And part of the reason that sheep need a shepherd is because, like sheep, we struggle. We are like sheep and we struggle. Jesus knows that we struggle. As a matter of fact, Jesus used the shepherd-sheep metaphor in Matthew chapter 9, verse 36. And I love this. It says, when Jesus saw the crowds, when he scanned the crowds, when he looked not just at the mass of people, but when he looked and saw the people, he looked and he had the ability to see individual lives among the masses. It says, when he saw the crowd, when he observed, when he made an assessment of the crowd, he felt compassion. He felt it deep within his gut. He was moved on the inside when he saw them because they were distressed and dejected like sheep without a shepherd. To be distressed means to be anxious. To be dejected means to be depressed. Jesus looked at the crowds and says, there's a lot of struggle going on. You are like sheep that have no shepherd, and sheep who have no shepherd are aimless. They'll go anywhere. Without a shepherd, they will live their lives confused, and they will get their lives in all kinds of trouble. And Jesus looks at us and he says, I see some of you feel as if you have been harassed and kicked around by life. I know who you are, and I have compassion on you. And I want to give you help so that you can cultivate a life that is not an anxious life where you're always wringing your hands about what am I going to do? What if, what if, what if? And not only like sheep do we struggle, but like sheep, we go our own way. A few years ago, the Associated Press ran this true story of what happened in a small village in eastern Turkey. There was a flock of sheep, about 1,500 of them. Their shepherds were allowing them to graze in the fields while they were eating breakfast, and evidently they were close to a cliff, and there was a lead sheep that decided that he would walk over to the cliff and just jump off. And can you guess what happened next? 1,500 sheep left off the cliff, 450 of them died laying on top of a willowy white pile. And the reason more didn't die is because they were jumping on the big pillow down there and they were okay. But underneath, 450 sheep died. And you might be thinking to yourself, I wonder if one of them, while they were in line getting ready to leap, didn't go, I don't know about this. Everybody keeps going over the cliff and nobody's coming back. What's up with that? Perhaps I should pause. Perhaps I should reflect. Maybe before I mindlessly go over the edge, I should think about this a little bit. But I'm a sheep. Sasha went. Sonny went. I guess I'll go. It couldn't be bad if they decided to do it. Sheep can make bad decisions, and guess what? So do we. The Bible echoes this in Isaiah 53:6. We all went astray like sheep. We all have turned to our own way, and the Lord has punished him, speaking of Jesus, for the iniquity of us all. We are all like sheep, and sometimes the anxiety that we feel in our life is simply magnified and exacerbated because we make decisions that are not in keeping with what is best for us. Some of us amplify anxiety because we see what other people do and we think, well, if they're doing it, it couldn't possibly be bad. I mean, we live anxious, hurried, exhausted, no margin lives because successful people do that. And so if they do that and I want to be successful, I might as well do that. And we look around, it seems like everybody's living that way, so we think it's normal. And we even see the cliff, and you know what? We go ahead and jump off with them. You don't have to. There is a better way. The Lord is a shepherd who provides much more than whatever the crowd is doing. He gives us so much more. We've talked about who He is. We've talked about who we are. Let's talk now for a bit about what does God provide, what God provides. I don't know if you know this, but I've been to prison. I've been three times. One time in Cameron, Missouri, just right up the road, and then twice at Leavenworth. And I can still remember the very thorough security measures I had to go through. And I can still hear in my mind the slamming of the jail cell doors behind me. It's like when they shut, it was like you're in and you're not getting out. And thankfully, the time that I did was short, and I got out. We had gone to those prisons in ministry as a church, so you knew that, didn't you? Thought maybe I had you there. Listen, I do believe this. You've all been to prison, and some of you are in it today. And the prison that I'm talking about is marked by discontent. It's a prison where you never feel that you get enough and you feel like you're always deserving more. It's a prison where you feel deprived, like there's something missing in your life. Max Lucado calls it the prison of want. The prison of want. But when the Lord is our shepherd, He gets us out of the prison. Verse 1 says, "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want." So the sermon is about cultivating a non-anxious life, and for some of us, anxiety is fed by the fear of not having enough. It's an anxiety that's brought on by really wondering this: is God good enough? Does God really care about me? Or am I a lone sheep that has wandered off and I am lost and there is no shepherd that is looking for me, wanting to rescue me? But the Bible is telling us if Jesus is our shepherd, then we don't have to live anymore imprisoned by want. So let's remind ourselves of the truth of this verse. So let's say this out loud together. And we're going to do it like our breath prayer, like I taught you last week. We're going to inhale, "The Lord is my shepherd." Then we're going to exhale, "I shall not want." Let's do this together. Big inhale, "The Lord is my shepherd." Exhale, "I shall not want." Let's do that again. Big inhale, "The Lord is my shepherd." Exhale, "I shall not want." One more time. Big inhale. "The Lord is my shepherd." Exhale. "I shall not want." I don't have to live in want. Now, this is what I know. In our honest moments, we are all needy people. In our honest moment, we all have wants. As a matter of fact, we are want factories. We produce want in our lives virtually all of the time. Now, some of this is normal and natural to be a human being. You want to be fed. You want to drink. You want shelter. You want protection. You want connection. There's nothing wrong with those basic kind of wants. Those are wants for survival. But we can overwant stuff. We can overwant attention. We can overwant success. We can overwant just about anything, and the Bible calls overwant lust. It is a over desire for something. But we can also underwant. You and I can underwant the very thing that God has provided, which is true, lasting satisfaction. What does the Bible mean when it says, I shall not want? Well, let me give you some in other words. Because the Lord is my shepherd, nothing is missing from my life. That's what that means. Can you look at your life and go, when I look at the sum total of my life, when I really look at it and I look at what really matters the most, what is it that centers me? What is it that helps me to live a non-anxious life? Can you say, because the Lord is my shepherd, because He protects, He provides, He disciplines, He heals, He companions, nothing is missing from my life. To say that the Lord is my shepherd, it means I am completely satisfied with God's management of my life. You see, a shepherd guides, a shepherd directs, a shepherd manages the life of the sheep for the sheep's good. When you came to faith in Jesus Christ, you said yes, not only to His rescue, to forgive you of your sin, but you said yes to Him to lead your life. And He leads your life by truth, the truth of Scripture, that sometimes will just go counter to what it is that you feel and what it is that you desire and what the culture says is really good. But do you live by the truth that Jesus wants you to live by? You have been given the Spirit of God, and the Spirit of God will make alive your spirit to the things of God, and He will convict you when you are walking astray, and He will convince you when you are walking on the right path. Are you living under the management of God? Because the Lord is my shepherd, I can't think of anything God could give me that would make me more content. That's a big one. Are you content? Are you content with your life? Contentment and ambition can live in the same life. Your ambition can be pointed toward the right thing, and you can experience contentment, or your ambition can be pointed in the wrong direction, and you're never content. You never are settled. There's always the stirring inside. You can't stop. You can't slow down. You can't rest because there's this engine, this internal operating system that just will not do anything but push and push and push and push, and you have no rest in your life. When I say that the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want, that means I'm going to make a conscious choice to live with passionate indifference to anything that wants to be ultimate in my life that is not God. Do you have a passionate indifference to what wants to control your life that is other than God? I'm content with what God gives me because I am content with God. The enemy of the human heart and the ally to anxiety is the devil. And the devil, from the Garden of Eden on, has put himself in a position to tempt us to not believe that God is on our side. The temptation is to say, God is holding out. God is stingy. God is a reluctant giver. He doesn't really want to give unless His arm gets twisted. And you go back and you read, did God really say? Paul says in Philippians 4, 11 through 13, I don't say this out of need, for I have learned to be content in whatever circumstances I find myself. Why? The Lord's a shepherd. I know how to make do with little. Do you know why? The Lord was a shepherd. And I know how to make do with a lot. You know why? Because the Lord is a shepherd. In any and all circumstances, I have learned the secret of being content, whether well fed or hungry, whether in abundance or in need. I am able to do all things through Him who strengthens me. Paul was able to live that kind of contented life because he knew who God was, he knew who he was, and he knew what it was that God provided. Vance Havner, an old revivalist preacher says this: faith in God will not get you everything you may want, but it will get for you what God wants you to have. Do you want what God wants you to have? The beauty of the Christian faith, let me draw this to a close. The beauty of the Christian faith is that the Lord, the self-existing, self-sustaining, uncontainable, inexhaustible, originator, creator, outside of time and space, is loving, compassionate shepherd. He gave up his life for you. It's the beauty of the Christian faith. The Lord, the one that is behind all things, the one that is outside of time and space, the one who created everything about you and everything that is willing to say, I will sacrifice myself for you. You can applaud that. That is a great truth. Jesus said this of himself, I am the good shepherd. John 10:11, the good shepherd lays down his life for his sheep. You are valuable to God enough that he laid down his life for you. But the Christian faith takes on an even greater beauty. If that's not beautiful enough, I don't want you to miss this. Don't check out. It takes on a greater beauty when you consider the fact that Jesus, our Lord, our King, willingly became like a sheep for you. He is the good shepherd. Yes, willing to lay down his life to become one like us, to become like a sheep. Listen to what prophet Isaiah said. He, speaking of Jesus, was oppressed and afflicted, yet he did not open his mouth, like a lamb led to the slaughter. And like a sheep silent before her shearers, he did not open his mouth. He did all of that to take messy, broken, struggling, aimless, go my own way, sheep people like me and you. He did all of that so that we could know what it is like to be loved completely by a God who doesn't want us to live a life that is overcome by anxiety. He wants us to live a life that is in unison with him. Jesus did all of that to pave a way so that you could know God in this life. This is not what I'm telling you. This is not a pipe dream. This isn't for certain people who are more spiritual than you. This is for you. This is for me. You can live this by experience. You just have to exercise faith. By faith, do you truly embrace that God is your shepherd and that he wants what's best for you? And are you willing to say, the Lord is my shepherd? That's enough. That's enough. Let me pray for us. Lord, some of us today, we need to stop moving away from you. You're looking for us. You've been looking for us all of our lives. We need to stop moving away. We need to stop going astray. And we need to allow your open arms to embrace us the way a shepherd would embrace a sheep when he would rescue it from danger. God, some of us need to return to the shepherd and the overseer of our soul. And I pray that you would help us do that this day. And would you let us know that we have nothing to lose except an anxious life when we acknowledge that you are our shepherd and we shall not want. I pray this in the name of Jesus, and we said everywhere, amen. All right, I am so glad that you came. Before you leave, we want to make sure that you know.
Thank you.